Hello, everyone. My name is Denise Croote, and I'm a PhD student at Mount Sinai and leader of Minds. In this podcast series, we will go behind the scenes to learn more about the lives of acclaimed neuroscientists and the pivotal moments in their careers. Today, we are joined by Dr. Daniela Schiller, a professor of neuroscience and psychiatry at the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai. She is also the director of the Schiller Laboratory of Effective Neuroscience. Dr. Schiller, your lab studies effective neuroscience. Can you tell us what that means?
Generally, effective neuroscience is the study of emotional learning and memory, social cognition and behavior, and these related processes.
So throughout your research, has there been one experiment or set of experiments that you feel really defines your career?
There have been a few, but I can think of one in particular that we started as soon as I started my lab. This was a study that asked how the brain is tracking social relationships. The reason it was unique was because the question wasn't asked before and wasn't studied before. So we had to define the question and we had to develop a whole new protocol to study it. And it led to very interesting discoveries. It actually led us from one field to another. We started from the emotional affective field and it led us to a field of memory and spatial cognition.
So what was the goal of this project? What were you searching for?
Well, we know from our everyday experience that social relationships are dynamic, right? For example, in your class or in your school, let's say it's the first day and you meet new people. And then over time through the interactions, some of them gain more power. For example, they become more popular, or you become more popular, and you also get very close to some and less to others. So you can think about it as an act of navigation. It's like a map, and people are located in this map of your social space, and you navigate through it, and you shape it using the interactions.
How did you expect the brain to monitor this?
The brain already has a navigation system. We navigate in space. This is a form of computation that finds relationship between continuous dimensions in the environment. And we thought it might use exactly the same mechanism to navigate in abstract space, in our social space.
You were testing whether the brain monitors these dynamic interactions using the same neural architecture that it would engage, say, if I were walking around a museum.
Yeah, that's correct. It's forming a map of the environment, whether it's in physical space or in abstract social space.
This sounds like a pretty innovative idea. So when you were beginning, were you met with any skepticism very early on?
Early on, I think my colleagues were just surprised of why am I actually asking that question, because it wasn't similar to anything I asked before. It was brand new also for me. But I was very excited and passionate, and I really wanted to pursue it. I was just curious. I wanted to know.
How would you do this in the laboratory?
That was the fun part, because if you know, most of laboratory experiments could be pretty boring. You would see stimuli presented on a computer, or you'll have to learn long lists of words and all sorts of not very interesting tasks. And I really wanted to have an interesting task to do that, to have it be very engaging and as naturalistic as possible. So what we did is wrote a story, and the story involved characters that you had to interact with. For example, you came to a new town and you had to get a job and to find a place to stay by interacting with the town's people. So it was something like a choose your own adventure game where everybody gets the same narrative, but because you make different choices, you will experience the story differently. And these choices are the ones that determined the structure of your social space. For example, if a character goes for a hug, and then you can choose whether to hug the character for a long moment or just give her a brief pat on the back. This is an affiliation interaction. That person can either get closer to you or away from you. So to imagine, I think of a game board when you interact with the character, it's as if you're moving the character one step toward you or one step away from you. But for you as a participant, you just experience the story. You read the text, you see the characters, and you make choices. And we take these choices and translate them into a geometric space, as if we put it on the game board and determine the coordinates of each character. And this gives us a quantity, a number that we can track in the brain. If the brain is encoding information in such a way, we would see brain dynamics that are similar to these numbers, to these movements of the characters on the game board.
Did you find that people tended to have a very similar interaction with each character, that it followed a certain trajectory, or did people change their minds throughout their interactions and characters kind of jump all over the board?
That was a very interesting aspect of the task because we could really see personalities. Some people aligned the character on the power dimension. One was the most powerful and then the other characters kind of ranked below. Some people didn't care about power at all. All the characters remained in somewhat of an equal power to the participant, but they were very much aligned on the affiliation dimension. So one was the closest to you and others were further away. Others pushed all the characters away and just got close to one character.
That's really interesting. And then you're looking to take that geometric structure and see if you can find some type of relationship to our brain activity. And how are you measuring brain activity here?
To measure brain activity, we use what we call the functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI. It's a machine where people lie inside and we can record hemodynamic responses. So it's essentially blood flowing to different regions of the brain. The more active a brain region is, the more blood flows, and we can detect that. And we can conclude for that there was enhanced activation in that particular region. And if we do it while people perform a task, we can see these changes in the brain over time as they do the different tasks.
Did you find that any one particular region of the brain was tracking these evolving relationships, or was it distributed across the brain?
The exciting thing was that we identified the hippocampus. This is a region that is involved in memory formation, but also in spatial navigation. This is the region that helps us navigate physical space. And we saw that this same region also tracks navigation in social space. And that was our initial hypothesis, that the brain would use the same machinery to navigate in different types of spaces.
Listening now, it sounds like, you know, everything adds up, but how long did this project actually take?
We started it in 2011 and published it in 2015. So 4 years.
That's really interesting to hear, because growing up in the American school system, you know, we do a lot of science labs, but they usually take 2 hours. And by the end of the lab, we know the answer to the question. We had our hypothesis, we tested it, and we figured out the answer. But it sounds like that isn't the case here.
Apparently not. When we do experiments, we have to be very, very careful, because each aspect of the study is very laborious. We invest a lot of time, funding, and training. So we want to be very careful. But also, from a scientific perspective, you can run an experiment, have conclusions, but then you can find out that actually the results could be explained by something completely else, because you didn't control your experiment very well. You really need to isolate the specific factor that you want to study. So we spend a good few months just thinking about the hypothesis and the appropriate experimental design. Some experiment could be faster if you use a method that has been used for decades. That could be a little more quick, but not too much.
How do you handle that, especially given that you don't know that you'll find something in the end?
Yes, it's very risky. But I think what drives you is that you really, really want to know. I like to think about it like these TV series that we get addicted to, for example, Game of Thrones. If you start, let's say, season 7, and then they give you an episode just once a week, you see it and then you wait for the next week and you're dying to see the next episode and you still wait. It's kind of the same feeling in an experiment. You just do all these steps because you really want to know.
When you were beginning this research, did you have an idea of the eventual impact that this social space project would have?
This was definitely a high-risk project. Not all projects are like that. Some projects, you're pretty sure that you'll find something. With this, we absolutely didn't know. And in this sense, it's very risky. Also, in some questions, you feel they're important, but it's not so clear that everybody will agree with you. And sometimes it's the other way around. You think that a question is just interesting, you're curious about it, and then you realize it was a pretty important question. As far as the social project goes, now it's we've just published some of the results and we are continuing, and we see some other labs also doing this line of research, and it's pretty exciting. It's not just us, it's many labs that have been studying different kinds of spaces, auditory spaces, olfaction spaces, concept spaces. So we feel that we are in a field that is growing.
I think it's really interesting to hear about those discoveries that have almost come about by accident or come about in an unforeseen way. Can you tell us a little bit about the different ways to develop a question or an idea?
The way I like to think about it is like writing music. There are artists that just write hits. You know, they know how to write hits. They know what the public would like. And it's a skill. Whereas other artists write from the heart. They just write in the privacy of their own room. They don't know if anyone will ever want to listen to it, and then it becomes a great hit. I think there's a similar approach in science where you could actively identify the important questions. It's not that easy, actually. It also requires a good eye to know what is an important question. But you can also just be very curious and have a strong intuition about something and pursue that. And that could become very impactful. There is a lot of unknown when you do science, but there are definitely many ways to come up with ideas.
We've talked a little bit about the time span of this project. Can you tell us about the people who worked on your team?
Every scientific project is a team project. It's very rare to see a science experiment done by one person alone. Each person brings different skills, and the project is a combination of these skills. A lot of brainstorming going on when you shape the ideas and the hypotheses, and sometimes it's even hard to know where the idea came from because it really came from the multiple brains interacting.
That's really interesting because one myth we would like to debunk here is that there is a right way to be a scientist or that a certain type of person makes a good scientist. And it sounds like a lot of people bring their own skill set to the table. So you've trained many people throughout your career. Can you tell us about the variety of people that have come through your laboratory?
There are definitely many personalities that can do science. There's no right way. Some could be the more of the extrovert type. They can go to many conferences and interact with many people and gain knowledge and collaboration through this type of work. Other can be more timid, introvert, but you can still communicate in different ways and develop your ideas and be part of the community. Some people would be more intuitive and creative in their approach to science. Some would be more analytic and using mathematical skills. Some would be interested more in the method development. Some would be more interested in the theory. all of these types can succeed.
You said the word creative, and I just want to circle back to that because I feel like we're often taught that science and art are two separate things. But in my experience, and it sounds like in your experience, the two find a way to weave together.
I think there's very close relationship between art and science. It's actually pretty hard to distinguish if you think about it as two forms that try to capture aspects of existence. In the arts, you try to capture moments and ideas and feelings. And it's pretty much the same in science. You want to capture phenomena that exists in the world and in our minds and in the ways we think. We just approach it slightly differently, but the end result could be quite similar or definitely complementary.
Before we end today's show, is there any advice that you would give to someone who is currently pursuing or considering pursuing a career in science?
The advice I've been following and like to give is to follow the three P's. The three P's are passion, patience, and perseverance. Passion, because as I said before, you really want to know, just like you want to really know the end of a story. This is how I think it will help to feel about your science project, because this is what will drive you through it. Patience, because as I described, some projects could take years, 3-4 years, and you wouldn't know until the end if it's going to work. And perseverance, because there are many hiccups. Sometimes you collect data and there are problems with the data. Sometimes you need to tweak your experiment. Every step should be done or could be done in many different ways, and you really need to persevere.
There we have it. Be passionate, be patient, and persevere all the while. Thank you all for joining us for our inaugural episode. And make sure to check back as we dive into the brains of several other outstanding scientists at Mount Sinai. Thank you, Dr. Schiller, for joining us today.
Thank you.